Welcome, welcome. You're on with another edition of the Bible Show Truth Hour here on the POET Network, hosted by Black Ice
and Brother Julius.
And this is part two. Last week was so explosive. We got so many people from our job and other places talking about how explosive our last week's lesson was, part one, brothers and sisters, of Biblical Myths Exposed. That we're going to run this series, and we're going to do a part two to this series also as well. So tonight's Biblical Myths Exposed is going to be on the law versus grace, brothers and sisters. The law versus grace. So we're going to ask that you get your Bibles, your pen, your paper. We want you to take notes. We don't want you to take our word for anything. We're going to give you these scriptures so that you can read them for yourself, brothers and sisters. We want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. We're going to start there since that's the place that's used the most to say that we're no longer under the law. Then why don't we start there? Why don't we start there? Why don't we go and hit this thing right in the head, brothers and sisters? Step right up into the jaw of the scripture that most people use to say that we are no longer under the law. Is that true? Is it part true? Is it being misinterpreted?
How about a better question, Black guys? What law are we not under?
Well, I'll ask you this off the top. Are you able to kill now? Are you able to steal now? Are you able to commit adultery now or fornication now without it being against God's law? And then we're going to go to the definition, brothers and sisters, of sin. We're going to go there. We're going to do all that during the course of our show. But right now, please share this video, brothers and sisters, because it's about to go down. It's about to go down. And actually, it's about to go up, too. All the way up. Nothing can stop us. All the way up. We're about to go up, too, brothers and sisters. So we want you to go ahead and turn your Bibles to Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Let's start there, Brother Julius.
Okay.
Hebrews, 10th chapter. Let's go right to the scripture that is used to say that we are no longer under the law. Then we're going to give some examples to see if this is actually true. They say that we're under a different dispensation of time.
Of grace.
Of grace. We're under a different dispensation of time. And because they use the word dispensation, you know, folks get all up in arms and they get all, you know what I'm saying? So we're going to deal with that and analyze that. So Hebrews, the 10th chapter, let's deal with verse 1. For the law.
For what?
The law. Having a shadow of good things to come. In other words, brothers and sisters, the shadow is not the actual thing. It's the image of the thing. You have a shadow when you're standing in the sun. Your shadow is not you. It's a representative of you. So this is saying right here, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come. So this particular law was a representative of what was to come. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image, there's the word image again, of the things, can never with those sacrifices.
Can never with those what?
Sacrifices which they offer year by year continually make the comers there unto perfect. In other words, you couldn't be made perfect, brothers and sisters, by whatever law this was talking about that dealt with sacrifices and offerings. But we're going to deal with that in a minute. We just wanted to read that to you to start the show.
I want you to read verse 2 also, brother.
For then would they have ceased to be offered.
Well, whatever this is to come, it's going to cease to be offered.
And whatever was offered under the law.
Go ahead.
Because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscience of sins.
Why? Go ahead.
I don't want to go no further, Brother Jew. I don't want to go no further. We're going to come back here, brothers and sisters, a little bit later on in the show. I want to hold that right now, Brother Julius.
Okay.
But can we explain to them what the definition of sin is?
Yes, we can. Let's go to 1 John 3:4. Because people are always saying, well, we're not under the law.
We're under grace. Right.
God loves you. No matter what you do, God loves you. Can you read that to me? Can you read that to me out of the Bible? For God love you no matter what you do.
1 John.
Mm-hmm. And pick it up at verse 3.
Let's go.
1 John, mm-hmm. The third chapter. And pick, start reading at verse 3, verse 4.
So we wanted to establish Hebrews, the 10th chapter, up front, brothers and sisters, because that is the chapter that's used to support the doctrine that we are no longer under the law. But we're going to analyze on this show the law versus grace on biblical myths exposed.
Uh-huh.
Part 2 is if that's actually the case, brothers and sisters. 1 John 3
and 4.
Whosoever committeth
means to continue in. Go ahead.
Commit of sin transgress also the law.
Transgress means to break.
For sin is the transgression of the law.
Today is what? Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
That's an absolute. When you see the word is, it points to something absolute. For sin
is the transgression or the breaking of the law.
No, sin is smoking and drinking.
No, uh-uh.
Sin is the transgression of the law.
Well, hold on, wait a minute, Brother Julius. So you mean to tell me if people are still capable of sinning,
uh-huh,
and if sin is still in existence, then in order to sin, there must be a law that you have broken.
It's all that simple.
So there is still law in existence. So much for the theory that we are no longer under the law, that we are under grace, brothers and sisters, because if sin still exists, then there must be laws that still exist in order for you to break, for it to be called sin.
Yes. Sin identifies something.
Mm.
What read verse 5, because it's a continuation of verse 4.
And you know that he was manifested,
or brought forth, yeah,
to take away our sins.
Uh-huh.
And in him is no sin.
There you go. So sin is the definition, according to the Bible, sin is the transgression of the law.
Mm.
And you know that he was manifested or brought forth to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. I want to hit that fifth verse because it's going to be pertinent later on, guys.
So hold on a minute. So now we dealt with sin a little bit, but now we got to deal with grace, brothers and sisters.
Uh-huh.
Did grace come into existence?
What is grace?
The time that Jesus sacrificed, or was it here already before Jesus came on the scene in the flesh through Mary? That's what we got to analyze right here, brothers and sisters. Because we dealt with law, and since they said, well, we're no longer under law, we're under grace, it would give you the impression that grace just got here.
Mm.
When Jesus sacrificed his life for our sins. So we're going to deal with that, brothers and sisters. We're going to deal with grace. We're going to deal some more with the law. We're going to deal some more with the sin, brothers and sisters, because we need to know tonight if we're still under law. See, many of us are doing things now because we got permission from the pastor and from our teachers and from those who we had reverence for. Mm-hmm. That told us, oh, you ain't got to worry about that no more. We ain't no longer under the law. That was the Mosaic law.
Mosaic law.
You ever heard that term before? The Mosaic law?
Mm.
As if Moses had some laws, that he was educated enough,
uh-huh,
that he was sin-free enough, that he was spiritual enough to give laws to humanity?
Uh-huh.
No, brothers and sisters, Moses only gave the children of Israel what was given to him to give. So was it the Lord's law or was it Moses' law?
Well, let's go to Ephesians chapter 2 and let's look at what people say that you're not under the law.
Oh, wait a minute. Y'all Old Testament Christians.
Mm.
Well, we was just in the book of 1 John. Before that, brothers and sisters, we were in the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter.
Right.
And now we're going to the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. So we haven't even dealt with the Old Testament yet, brothers and sisters, or what you call the Old Testament, but Jesus called it Scripture.
There you go.
So from the book of Genesis to Malachi, mm-hmm. Jesus called those books scriptures. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are testimonies of the life and the times of Jesus. But they were not called scripture. The writings of Paul, brothers and sisters, are letters written to the church, but they are not called scriptures. Jesus called scripture from the book of Genesis to the book of Malachi. Mm-hmm. So we're breaking all this stuff down for you on tonight's show. Yeah. We're in the book of Ephesians.
Ephesians chapter 2. Uh-huh. Because this is what people hide behind, not understanding Paul's writings completely.
Okay.
Ephesians chapter 2, and pick it up at verse 4, because they're going to say, we under grace, we're not under the law, we under the grace, we saved by grace. Come on, Black. 2 and 4.
Ephesians 2 and 4.
And 4, go ahead.
But God,
yes,
who is rich in mercy.
Who is rich in what?
Mercy.
Mercy, huh? Mercy, that means that you have been given something or some repentance or a chance to repent for something that you transgressed.
And not only that, brothers
and sisters. Be merciful to me.
Mercy is undeserved forgiveness, brothers and sisters. But the Lord knows that although we do not deserve to be forgiven, it says he is rich in mercy.
Go ahead.
For his great love wherewith he loved us.
He loved you so much, Black, that he said that his desire that any should perish. Go ahead.
Even when we were dead in sins.
You were dead in what?
Sin.
So sin is the transgression of what?
Of the law.
So we were dead and we were lawbreakers. Go ahead, Ice.
Have quickened us together with Christ.
Made us alive through Christ. Go ahead.
By grace, you are saved.
And this is what they say. You're not under the law. You're under the grace. I'm saved by grace.
That's right.
Ooh, wow. Come on, Black.
And have raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
And you will sit there. In other words, he's giving you the words of eternal life, whereby now you can stop sinning against him and walk in newness of life. So he gave you another chance. Grace, something that you obtained that you did not deserve.
That's true.
The two twins, grace and mercy. It's always been here. Go ahead, Black. Verse 7. Because we're talking about dispensation of grace in the law.
That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Jesus Christ.
One more verse.
For by grace are ye saved through faith.
Oh, faith is belief. Belief is a big thing.
That's right.
You have to believe. Then Jesus told you to those who believed on his name that you would be saved. For by grace you are saved through faith.
And that not of yourselves.
Oh, you didn't do anything to deserve that.
It is the gift of God.
So, by grace is the free gift or unmeasurable favor, something that you obtained that you did not deserve. And it did not start in the New Testament.
Well, let's go back and see where it started, brothers and sisters, because again, we would believe, according to what's taught to us, that grace came into existence at the moment that Jesus gave up the ghost and he died for our sins. Now grace has all of a sudden appeared on the scene. Well, let's see if grace had been here before Jesus died for our sins. Let's go to the book of Genesis, the 6th chapter, brothers and sisters, and let's see if we can find grace all the way in the beginning of this book. Genesis, the 6th chapter. Let's see if we can find grace here. Our subject matter today is Biblical Myths Exposed, Part 2.
Yeah.
Grace versus the law. There are some say that we are no longer under the law, but we're under grace. Well, in the beginning, if you just tuned in, we found out that the definition of sin is the transgression or the breaking of the law.
Yeah.
So if sin is still in existence, and show me someone that who is not a sinner, brothers and sisters, that you know of. Because we're all doing something, brothers and sisters, that is in violation.
And if you do find someone, which you will not, because the Lord has concluded that
I like the way you said that, brother.
All have sinned.
And fallen short.
And come short. What? Of the grace of God.
Of the glory. So, brothers and sisters, so if we know that there's no one on earth who is sinless, then sin still exists, then there must be some type of law that each and every one of us is in violation of, knowingly or unknowingly, brothers and sisters. So we talked about law. We talked about the definition of sin, which is the breaking of the law.
Right.
Now we are on grace, brothers and sisters. We just read that grace in the book of Ephesians said it was a free gift. It was a gift from God.
Unmerited favor.
Undeserving gift. But let's see if we can find grace in the Bible before Jesus died for our sins. Genesis, the 6th chapter. We're going to start this off, brothers and sisters, at...
pick it up at verse 5.
Verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And he repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth.
And look what the Lord said he was going to do, Black. Go ahead and read it.
Brothers and sisters, this is so powerful right here that Jesus wanted to do a recall on his creation. This is when he decided that I'm going to bring a flood in and I'm going to start all over with Noah and his three sons and their wives.
Look what the Lord said in verse 7. Nice. Go ahead.
I got to read verse 6 more time, Brother Julius. Because we were damaged goods. Don't you know how you have a product and they said, we're going to recall the product. We found a defect. Jesus said in verse 6, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart.
Because man had went against the commandments of God. Come on, Black.
And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, and the fowls of the air, for it repented me that I have made them.
What?
But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, brothers and sisters. So the first time grace ever appeared in the Bible was in the book of Genesis, the 6th chapter and the 8th verse. And it said that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. This was before the sacrifice of Jesus, brothers and sisters, in what is called the New Testament, brothers and sisters. So grace had already been here. But there was laws still here during the time of Noah. And this was before Moses came on the scene, brothers and sisters.
Wow.
So what are we saying when we're saying that we're no longer under the law, we're under grace, brothers and sisters?
What are you saying?
Can even point back to Adam and Eve, when they disobeyed in the Garden of Eden, and the Lord decided that I'm going to allow you to live and have children and not destroy the both of you right now. That was grace also, brothers and sisters. So you can actually point back to grace going all the way back to the garden.
Wow.
So now we know we got grace in existence. And we got the law in existence, brothers and sisters.
And mercy.
And mercy in existence, brothers and sisters. So, what law are we talking about when it's talking about in Hebrews the 10th chapter, which is what we first read, that the law having a shadow of things to come, but not the very image of the thing, brothers and sisters. And then it started talking about sacrifices and offerings. Can we go to the book of Genesis?
Yeah.
The 7th chapter. Let's go to the book of Genesis, the 7th chapter. Now, we're about to take you on a journey. This is what you call learning something on the way to learning something. Genesis, the 7th chapter. Just turn your Bibles over to the next page. Now, we've all learned in church and in Bible school that Noah took every animal into the ark 2 by 2.
That's what we've been taught.
That weren't you taught that during the course of your life?
Yes, sir.
And I was taught that during the course of my life. Uh-huh. And those of you who are watching on Facebook Live and on YouTube was taught that during the course of your life, that Noah took every animal into the ark 2 by 2. Well, we're going to read something that the Bible says versus what we were taught. And the Lord said unto Noah, Genesis 7:1, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation.
Right.
A very clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens.
Uh-huh.
Whoa.
What?
It ain't two?
Of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens.
Well, wait a minute now. They told me that Noah took every animal into the ark two by two. This is why this is called the Bible, the Truth Hour Bible Show, brothers and sisters. Because no matter how much affection you have for your pastor, no matter how much you love you have had for your parents and your grandparents, you got to put what they taught you up against what the Bible says, brothers and sisters.
Yep.
And the Bible is going to trump anything else all the time. Now, verse 2, Genesis 7 and 2, a very clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens, the male and his female. And of the beasts that are not clean, by two, the male and the female.
Uh-huh.
So, brothers and sisters, here the Lord is establishing something. He's separating clean animals from unclean animals. Why would you tell me to bring more clean animals into the ark, Lord, than unclean animals? Son, why? I'm only going to permit you to eat animals that are clean. And I'm only going to permit you to sacrifice unto me animals that are clean. So wouldn't it make sense that you would need more clean animals than unclean animals? Because you were going to have to do more with the clean animals than the unclean animals.
There you go.
Let's go to the book of Leviticus.
Yeah.
Leviticus, the 11th chapter, brothers 11. And sisters. Because now you got to ask the question that if the Lord separated clean animals from unclean animals, now we got to define what those animals are. And we're still dealing with the law versus grace, brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. And we're going to put this thing together for you. So just hold on, Brother Julian.
Matter of fact, we're going to read a law about things that are permissible to eat and things that are not permissible to eat. This is a law.
Hmm.
But,
are we breaking that?
Be careful, brother.
Did you go to Red Lobster anytime?
Be careful, brother.
Did you get your lobster and your snail? Did you? Okay, I'm sorry. Did you eat your catfish?
Be careful, I said.
Okay, all right, cool. Leviticus, the 11th chapter.
And verse 1.
And the Lord spake unto Moses.
No, the Mosaic law.
No, this is the Lord speaking to Moses and Aaron, uh-huh. saying unto them,
yes.
speak unto the children of Israel, saying, these are the beasts which you shall eat.
Well, Black Ice, if this is for the children of Israel, this the rest of the world don't count, do it?
No, brothers and sisters, because see, if you are in the body of Christ, whether you are biologically Israel or not, you have become spiritual Israel by the circumcision of your heart.
The Bible says one law shall be to Israel and the stranger that joins themselves unto Israel.
One law.
One faith.
One baptism, brothers and sisters.
One doctrine, one spirit.
Mm.
One Lord and Savior for all. So what's good? Israel is just happened to be the microcosm of the world, chosen as a representative to the world and a light unto the world by God. The chosen people.
Wow.
Come on, Black.
Verse 2, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, these are the beasts which you shall eat among all the beasts that are on the earth.
Among everything called beasts.
So wait a minute.
On the earth.
This is the Lord telling Moses and Aaron to tell us this. Now, the question I ask you is, do the God that we serve change?
God does not change. The book says Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, and he changes not.
Wow. Verse 3, whatsoever parteth the hoof, that's one.
Split hoof.
And is clove-footed.
Four-foot.
That's two. And cheweth the cud among the beasts, that shall you eat. You need three requirements, brothers and sisters.
Always chewing. Always chewing. The grass, the leaves. Always chewing.
Verse 4, nevertheless, these shall you not eat of them that chew the cud, or them that divideth the hoof, as the camel, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof. He is unclean unto you. He doesn't have all three requirements, brothers and sisters. Verse 5, and the cooney, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof, he is unclean to you.
Go ahead.
and the hair.
Now, who is saying God created and made everything. I think he know what's clean and unclean. Everything that God created was very good,
right?
But not good to eat. That's why he set it apart. He know what he's doing. Come on, Black.
Leviticus 11 and 5. And the coney, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof, he is unclean unto you. Uh-oh, wait a minute, Brother Julius.
Here we go.
Your bacon lovers and your ham lovers.
Stop it. I told you to be careful.
And your hot dog, which has pork ingredients in it, lovers. And your marshmallow lovers. Man. And your gummy bear lovers, your gelatin lovers.
Okay. Read the book, man.
Leviticus 11 and 6.
Yeah. 11 and 6.
And 11 and 7. And the swine, though he divideth the hoof and be clove-footed, so he has two out of the three requirements, yet he cheweth not the cud. He is unclean unto you. Well, of their flesh you shall not eat.
What is the, look at verse 6, Ice. What is this?
Anything in the family of the hare, and some say the rabbit is also in the family of the hare.
Wait a minute. Read verse 6.
And the hare.
And the what?
And the hare.
Now, we've been taught a hare is a rabbit. Now, whatever it is, look what it divides not.
Because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof.
When do rabbits have hoofs?
They don't.
Whatever this is, just throwing something out there. Do your own investigation. Read, Ice.
Verse 8, of their flesh you shall not eat, and their carcass you shall not touch. They are unclean unto you.
Listen, what is a carcass?
A body.
A body. But a dead body.
That's right.
Because while that swine is alive, you can handle him. But once he's dead, you can't touch him.
That's right.
And you can't eat him while he's alive. And you can't kill him. Well, nonetheless, another time. What about verse 9?
Verse 9. Uh-oh, wait a minute. These are your seafood lovers here. These are your seafood lovers. These are the requirements of seafood if you choose to eat seafood. Leviticus 11 and 9. These shall you eat of all that are in the waters.
All?
Whatsoever have fins and scales in the waters, in the seas, in the rivers, them shall you eat. And all that have not fins and scales, two requirements.
It must have fins and scales, not or and scales. Go ahead,
In the seas and in the rivers, of all that move in the waters, and of any living thing which is in the waters, they shall be an abomination unto you. So you can't eat catfish, brothers and sisters.
What about calamari? Squid.
Wow, no, you can't do squid. You can't do shark. You can't do lobster. You can't do snail.
Crab.
You can't do crab. And it,
shrimp.
And it not be a violation of God's law, brothers and sisters. And I know this going to hurt some of you. But before we start pointing out that someone is a homosexual, Kim Burrell.
Ice.
Before we start pointing out anybody else's sin, see what you're violating first, brothers and sisters. Ooh. And see what we're violating first, brothers and sisters. Before we point out somebody else's sin. Because we all are guilty of something. Now, what are you all going to say who are listening online right now with Black Ice and Brother Julius? God changed that. He said, don't call that unclean, which I have called clean. Brothers and sisters, we're taking you to this journey because we're going to go all the way back to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, brothers and sisters. But we got to answer those unanswered questions that you have in your mind.
Biblical myths exposed.
Well, see, again, somebody told you, well, we ain't under that law no more. Because God said in the New Testament, don't call that unclean, which I have made clean.
Call what unclean?
Can we go there?
Let's go there.
Let's go to the book of Acts, the 10th chapter, brothers and sisters.
Don't get in trouble. Get in trouble good.
Acts, the 10th chapter. Are we still under the law? Or are we under grace?
Is God's dietary law still good?
Wow. Let's find out.
Because grace is here.
Let's find out. Somebody told me that in the book of Acts, the 10th chapter, that changed. God said, don't call that unclean, which I have made clean. We're going to go to Acts, the 10th chapter, verses 9 through 15. We're going to read that real quick. Acts, the 10th chapter, verses 9 through 15. It says, on the morrow, on the next day, as they went up on their journey and drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth hour, and he became very hungry and would have eaten, But while they were making the food ready, he fell into a trance.
But he was hungry. He would have eaten, but he fell into a trance.
And saw heaven open, and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners, like a scroll, and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air.
Sound like everything that he named in Genesis, the first chapter, and Leviticus, the 11th chapter.
That we're not supposed to eat. But look at what happens here. Acts 10 and 13. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean."
I'm just not now starting not to eat.
No, he said, "I've never eaten anything common or unclean." And the voice spake unto him again the second time, "What God has cleansed, don't call it common." Now, if we just stop there, brothers and sisters, we could convince you that the dietary law is no longer in existence. Mm. That what we just read in Leviticus, the 11th chapter, about the swine, about the camel, about the cooney, and about the fish is no longer on the books. If we just stop there. But what we teach on this show, brothers and sisters, is that you must establish a subject matter to understand the chapter. So let's go back to the beginning of the chapter.
Well, before you go back, read verse 16 and 17. It's pertinent.
This was done three times, uh-huh, and the vessel received up again into heaven.
One more verse.
Now, while Peter doubted in himself what the vision was. While he doubted in himself what the vision he had seen should mean.
Oh, so Peter trying to find out what the Lord is trying to tell him, what the vision, what the trance. He fell into a trance. He was shown something in a trance, in a vision.
That's right.
I'm emphasizing this, sisters and brothers, because too many people say it's actually this right here. The Lord is getting ready to show Peter something.
It says, "Behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate." So now we got men that's inquiring about Peter. We got a man by the name of Cornelius that's mentioned up in here. But see, the pastors and the preachers who teach this, that you can eat anything you want to eat, all you got to do is pray over it, or we're no longer in the old law, in Leviticus, the 11th chapter, the dietary law, they don't go back to the beginning of the chapter, uh-huh, nor do they go beyond what we just read. Now let's go back to the beginning of the chapter. It says, Acts 10 and 1, "There was a certain man in Caesarea,
yep,
called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band. A devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always." Now, we've already established what the subject matter of this chapter is. It's about a man named Cornelius. He was an Italian. He was a Gentile, brothers and sisters. He was a devout man.